Please open your Bibles first to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, and in a moment we will read verse 58. You will also need your Bible to remain open. I want to take you and reference other passages of Scripture as we make our way through the message this morning. I'd like to share a message entitled, A Unifying Strategic Vision. I begin by asking you a very important question. Do you personally believe that God has a unique vision for Field Street Baptist Church in this season? Furthermore, have you ever imagined what our church might become under the full surrender of the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Thomas Watson Sr., you may know the story. He was 40 years old when he became manager of a little firm that made meat slicers, time clocks, and punch card machines. He recognized very quickly the potential of a machine used for processing and storing information, i.e., computers, 10 years before it began to be used commercially. To match his vision, he renamed his company International Business Machines Corporation. Toward the end of his life, he was asked at what point did he envision that IBM would become so big, and he answered, right at the beginning. Right at the beginning. One thing I know to be absolutely true about Field Street Baptist Church, and it's this: God has a plan and a purpose for this fellowship. Now, how do I know that? Well, I know that because that's what the Scripture says. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, the Bible says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope." I am convinced that God has a plan and a purpose for Field Street Baptist Church. And so I want to share with you this morning what God continues to keep on my heart and mind. And I want to remind you of what our vision is under the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And it is my prayer this morning that at the conclusion of this message, that you will want to grab hold of this vision as I pray the vision grabs hold of you. Now, there are four critical aspects of this vision that I want to remind you of this morning. This is not the first time that I have shared this sense of what God has as a purpose and plan for Field Street Baptist Church. Let me tell you the origin of this vision, if you will. Back in 2003, I was with Beth. We were at a conference in Memphis, Tennessee. We had been invited to participate in the Pastors Training Institute led by Adrian Rogers. It was one of those rare privileges you have as a young pastor. And we were invited to go and participate, and I was sitting in a room of about 50 other pastors with Adrian Rogers, and we were just simply picking his brain. And what a brain to pick. It was just a little slice of heaven on earth to be in the same room with Dr. Rogers, to pick his brain about leadership and pastoring, and especially preaching. And later that night in the hotel room, I remember sitting at the desk in the hotel room just saying, "God, I'm brand new at Field Street Baptist Church. It's a wonderful church. Please don't let me mess it up. Will you give me some sense of what you want, what your vision, your plan, your purpose is for Field Street Baptist Church? Will you give me something I can hang my hat on as long as you have me at Field Street Baptist Church?" And lo and behold, be careful what you ask for. God, just in the next several moments that evening, just poured it out into my brain, and I wrote it down just as fast as I could, because you know, ideas are fleeting and they can go as quickly as they come. And sometimes the best ideas, you are wise to write them down just as quickly as you can before you lose them. And so I believe with all my heart that what I'm sharing with you yet again this morning is exactly what God gave to me in that evening some 15 years ago. First of all, regarding the four aspects of this vision, our vision is to see every member of this congregation who is physically able to do so actively engaged in the work of the Lord. Now, all aspects of this vision begin with the word W. And it's great that it works out that way because it's easier to remember. But that is our desire, to see everyone connected with this fellowship, engaged at some level in the work of the Lord. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, verse 58. So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and steady, always enthusiastic about the Lord's work. For you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Now, this verse implies at least that we have work to do. And not only do we have work to do, but we have the Lord's work to do. Our work is rooted deeply in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And just so we're very clear about the gospel of Jesus Christ, let me make certain we are all on the same page so that we know what we are talking about when we speak of the gospel of Jesus Christ. The biblical gospel of Jesus Christ entails his sinless life, his atoning sacrificial death on the cross, his burial, and his resurrection by the power of God. That is the gospel to which we have committed ourselves to and of which we build our work upon. The truth is, as you well know, whether we like it or not, whether we want it or not, change has come to Cleburne and is coming to Cleburne. You know, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that the only person in all of the world that likes change is a baby with a dirty diaper. That's it, as best as I can tell. But change is here. Our culture is changing. You do not have to be a sociologist to figure out the radical dynamics of change in the current cultural climate. How people view family, how they view their time, how they look at politics, entertainment, money, priorities, and even the church has changed so dramatically in the last 5 years. The construction of the Chisholm Trail Parkway has brought significant change and opportunity to our community. And it's exciting, really, to consider the possibilities for both Cleburne and our church. But let me tell you what has not changed, and that is our work. We must renew our fervor to be faithful to the call and the command of Christ to the Great Commission. In Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20, Jesus said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you, and be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So our work has not changed. We are called to fulfill the Great Commission. We are to engage a culture which desperately needs Jesus. And we are to make disciples. In fact, the controlling verb of the Great Commission is not go. The controlling verb is to make disciples. Now, a disciple is one who follows Christ. A disciple then imitates his teacher. So we have to always find the balance as a church between evangelism and discipleship. Which is most important? They're both important. It's like saying which wing of an airplane is the most important, the left or the right. They're both important. We must always seek to find the balance between evangelism and discipleship. Furthermore, it's clear in verse 58 that we are to be enthusiastic about the Lord's work. Now, the work of the Lord is the greatest work that we have the privilege in which to engage, to work for Christ, to serve our Lord, to serve our Savior. There's no greater privilege. Sometimes, and I recognize this for all of us, if we're not careful and diligent, we may lose our enthusiasm for the Lord's work. But we cannot, like the church in Ephesus, lose our first love. We cannot lose our passion for the Lord and his work, especially for the Lord. The work is far too important for any of us to grow weary in well-doing. I often hear people say, you know what? I'm tired. Well, join the club. I'm tired. We're all tired. No kidding. I've served my time. Let the younger people do it. I'm retired. I don't enjoy doing that anymore. I'm too busy. Or, preacher, that's your job. Or the staff. That's what we pay y'all to do. And then I hear others say, well, I want what I want, and if you don't give me what I want, then I'm going to leave the church. Now, the interesting thing about both attitudes is this: neither are found in the Bible. I've looked. Friends, you are never eligible for retirement in the work of the kingdom of God. My in-laws, Vic and Joanne Barris, are just great examples for me and my family. And they are working harder now in retirement than I think they did when they were gainfully employed. And that's not to say anything about their work habits before. They just view their retirement days as days in which to extend the work of Christ in and through their lives to his glory. I think that's a great model. There is no sense for the Christian that you retire. And until the King calls you home, the scripture is clear that you are a laborer in the vineyard for a divine purpose and reason. And so the church is a body, a family, and functions best when all of us consider each other more highly than ourselves. The truth is, at least for me, I plan and hope to preach until I have no more breath. I recognize the day is going to come when I will walk away from pastoring Field Street Baptist Church. You had other pastors before I came. You'll have other pastors after I go. But I will continue working for the King in his kingdom. And I pray that all of us will renew our fervor for the work of the kingdom, the work of Christ. Furthermore, our Father's work is a shared work. In 1 Corinthians 12, verse 7, Paul says, a spiritual gift is given to each of us, that is, believers, as a means of helping the entire church. What a beautiful way in which God has put together the body of Christ. You see, the head of the church is Jesus Christ. He is the one true head of the body of Christ. And so each of us, we are a part of that body, and God, in his grace, through his Spirit, gifts us in such a way that as we work and serve together, the church functions in a very healthy and optimal way. So the work of the church, Christ's work, the work of the kingdom, is a shared work. And we use the gifts that God has given us to build his church and bring glory to him. So our vision is that God will enable every member connected to this church that's physically able to be engaged at some level in the work of the Lord. But there's a second aspect in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. If you would, open your Bible there to Acts 1, verse 8. And here we see that our vision is to be a church where every member is a witness for the Lord. Acts 1:8 says, but when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, you will receive power and will tell people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So the Bible makes very clear that we are witnesses and that we are to bear witness of and for Jesus Christ. Now, what is a witness? A witness simply tells what he or she has seen, heard, or experienced. And the testimony of a witness can be quite powerful. Our target area as Field Street Baptist Church, of course, our Judea, is Cleburne, Texas, right here in Johnson County. Now, the city limit signs inform us that we have a population of somewhat over 30,000 people in our city. Cleburne is a steady and good community. Some projections indicate that by the year 2025, that the population of Johnson County is projected to exceed 250,000 people. What that means is there are lots of lost and unchurched people in our region. So we must recommit ourselves to being faithful ambassadors, ministers of reconciliation in all the arenas where God has placed us, where we work, where we live, where we recreate, where our kids go to school, where we shop, where we buy groceries, where we dine. All of these places can be, if we will see them this way, mission fields. A lot of us have the tendency to think, well, I'm really not an evangelist, so I'm very uncomfortable telling people about Christ, sharing my faith. And I don't know the Roman road, and I don't know how to do evangelism explosion, and I really didn't get in on the faith evangelism program, so I really don't have a program in my tool belt that is useful in moving conversations about Christ with other people. Well, I'd like to give you some level of comfort here. There are a variety of ways to engage people for Christ. And sometimes, if we're not careful, we can get hung up on having what is called a confrontational strategy for evangelizing, that we forget the power of relational evangelism. And see, I think we are better served, especially if we're going to be in a community long term, we're better served to look at evangelism as gardening, working a garden. It takes time and attention and tenderness in a lot of ways. And I'm not a gardener, but the analogy works well for me in the sense that building relationships with people, getting to know their names, getting to know their likes and dislikes, learning about their families, learning about what's going on in their lives gives you a front door into entering into a conversation with people about Christ. The most effective evangelists that I know, people who are very good at sharing their faith, are just those simply that ooze Christ almost out of every pore of their being. Does your life say that Jesus is important to you? Are you working the relationships that God has put in your life for the purpose of Christ? Are you moving those conversations of daily life with others toward Jesus and bearing witness for Him? All of us know, but it's good to be reminded that the church is not a country club. The church is not meant simply to be a place where you get and receive. Rather, the church is a body, it's a family, it's a network of people working together to serve, to reach those who are separated from God, the God who loves them. And the church is made up of what? It's people. And people who are less concerned with themselves and more concerned with God's agenda, which involves reaching out to a lost and decaying world, starting right here in Cleburne and moving beyond this city. Remember, it was Jesus who taught the disciples that they were to be salt and light. And He said that we are to be the salt of the earth, not the salt of the church. So you don't salt with salt. What does that mean, essentially? Well, separation from sin, absolutely. But isolation from sinners, absolutely not. Please ask yourself this morning, do you have any friends, any associates? Is there anyone in your life that's not a Christian? And if the answer is, well, no, then I'm certain that God wants you to expand your sphere of influence, because you are salt and light in a world that desperately needs it. I have plenty of friends. They're as lost as they can be. And I'm convinced that God has me in their life for a sovereign purpose, an eternal purpose. And so you work those relationships in such a way to move the conversations towards matters of the spiritual, especially what will they do with Christ. I want to give you 10 characteristics very quickly that distinguish great outreach churches. 10 characteristics that distinguish great outreach churches. Number one, a commitment to Bible study. Number two, a commitment to prayer. That there's this sense of nothing of eternal, spiritual sticking value is going to take place in the life of a church without a commitment on the body's part to prayer. Number three, a genuine love for lost people, not a genuine disgust. Number four, an obedience to the Great Commission, seen as a privilege. Number five, a vision for what people can become in Christ. Number six, a willingness to adapt to the culture without compromise to win people to Christ. Number seven, an involvement of every person in a small group. Number eight, involving people in ministry according to their spiritual gifts. Number nine, giving pastoral care primarily through small groups. And number 10, engaging in many ministries to reach people for Christ. We simply just cannot shirk our responsibility to seek and engage those who have yet to give themselves to Jesus Christ. There's this great story. I wonder if you've heard about it. The story is about a man by the name of Richard Van Fom. I think I'm saying his last name right. He thanked God and the United States Navy some years ago for saving him after he spent 3 months adrift at sea in a disabled sailboat. Rescuers credited Van Fom's ingenuity in collecting rainwater in 5-gallon buckets and catching fish, sea turtles, and gulls. His saga began when he found himself caught in a storm as he sailed from Long Beach, California to Santa Catalina Island. So instead of 25 miles, Van Fom sailed over 3,000 miles. And when he was asked by reporters, his comment was, "When I see ship, happy." He said, "God saved me, so I'm here." Now, his rescue is even more dramatic and actually maybe even more miraculous because no one was looking for him. He failed to tell anyone where he was going. Now, here's the point. People are caught, as you know. They are caught in the storms of life. They are off course. They are drifting in a sea of marital problems, financial debt, difficulties with children, pain and heartache from poor decisions, unfulfilling careers. And if the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is not out looking for the lost, then frankly, their hopes of being saved become very, very slim. I wonder if you might be willing this morning to consider making a commitment to God, and the commitment would be this: God, with your help and your guidance, in this year, I'm going to do my best to lead someone to faith in Jesus Christ. Will you give me that privilege and give me that opportunity and open the door for me to do this? One person in the next 12 months. Would you be willing to make that commitment? Our vision is to see a church where everyone considers himself, herself, a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a third aspect. Our vision is to see a church where the Word of God is preached and taught. I want you to open your Bibles now to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. 2 Timothy 4, verse 2. Now, as you know, we are a worshiping community. This is the best hour of the week for the Christian, to come together with the people of God, to the house of God, to gather around the Word of God, and to worship Him, to exalt Christ, to see the Spirit unleashed among God's people, to renew our hearts toward Him. We are a worshiping community. The highest value in our church is worship. We exist to worship God. Our worship, we pray, will be God glorifying, Christ exalting, Spirit unleashing, and hear this, Word driven. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, "All Scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out and teaches us to do what is right." Then look at 2 Timothy 4:2. Paul says to Timothy, "Preach the Word of God. That's an imperative. It's not an option. The Word of God can never be a side dish in the Lord's church. God have mercy on churches where the Word of God is simply a side dish. Paul says, preach the Word of God. Be persistent, whether the time is favorable or not. Patiently correct, rebuke, and encourage your people with good teaching. Romans 10:14 says, how will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how will they hear without a brass band? That's not what it says. It says this, and how will they hear without a preacher? Isaiah 61:1 says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me. This was a prophetic word regarding Jesus Christ. And Jesus quoted this when he entered one of the synagogues that day and said, today this scripture has been fulfilled in your very presence. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners. Listen again to what Paul says to Timothy in 1 Timothy 4, verse 13. He says, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preaching and to teaching. So you have my word, church, that I'm going to labor to be ready to step behind this sacred desk and preach the word. Not just because I love preaching, I do, but I love God more and I love you. In fact, I suggest to you and submit to you that my greatest pastoral duty and my greatest pastoral privilege is not necessarily to stand with you in the hospital room, but to stand here and preach the Word of God. I am going to continue to preach my guts out. Field Street Baptist Church stands on the primacy of God's Word. And Field Street will be a place that you can be certain His message will be preached and taught. And the Bible will not be a side dish and casually referenced in worship. The Word of God will be declared and trumpeted to the glory of God and for the sake of God's people. So we will not relent in our commitment to teach Scripture. Now the question certainly arises, well, why the Bible? Why do we put such an emphasis on Sunday school? And why the primacy of preaching in the church? By the way, Sunday school is our church organized and mobilized to systematically teach and apply the truths of the Bible and carry out the New Testament functions of the church. But why the Bible? Because the Bible is the Word of God. It is inspired. It is infallible. It is inerrant. It is authoritative. It is all-sufficient. The Bible is God's revelation of Himself to man. How incredible is it to have a Bible? I've said this before, but maybe it bears repeating. I have a friend who serves in a very dangerous part of the world. And often he will call upon me and others. We're a part of his prayer team that supports him in prayer. Pray for us today because we are attempting to get Bibles to people who have none. Now, preaching this to a congregation at Field Street Baptist Church in Cleburne, Texas, about getting a Bible, all of us are like, whatever, in a sense, because we have Bibles everywhere. I have probably 10 different Bibles. What a privilege to have a copy of the Word of God. There are people in the world who have no access to the Bible. Can you believe that? So, of course, we bear down and pray for the fruitfulness and the success of getting one copy of Scripture into the hands of someone who's never read the Bible before. And we know how important this is because the Bible is God's revelation of Himself to man. The Bible has God for its author. It has salvation for its end without any mixture of error for its matter. All Scripture is a testimony to Christ. And so when we preach His Word and teach His Word, it demonstrates the power of the Spirit and the power of God to draw men to Christ. This needs to be articulated as well. It wouldn't bother me if you write it down. The power is not in the preacher. The power is not in the messenger. It's the message that draws men to Christ. Yet, of course, the preacher is God's anointed and appointed to lead His church as elder, shepherd, and bishop. The preacher is God's messenger. But the power, forever and always, will be in the message of God's Word. Early in his ministry, when he was pastor of Congregational Church, I believe you say it in Rugeley, G. Campbell Morgan studied hard and preached often. He was discovering and developing the gift of Bible exposition that later made him a very popular expositor. His preaching made him quite popular itself, and one evening as he sat in his study, he felt God saying to him, "What are you going to be, a preacher or my messenger?" As Morgan pondered the question, he realized that his desire to become a great preacher was actually hindering his work. For several hours, Morgan sat there struggling with God's call and human ambition. And finally, he said this, quote, "Thy messenger, my master, thine," end quote. Get this. He took the precious outlines of his sermons, messages that he was quite proud of and labored over extensively, and laid them in the fireplace where they burned to ashes. That was when the victory was won. As the outlines were burning, Morgan prayed this, quote, "If thou wilt give me thy words to speak, I will utter them from this day forward, adding nothing to them, taking nothing away. Thine whole counsel I will declare, so help me God," end quote. We will build this church on the message of the Bible. God help us. It was Charles Spurgeon. It's one of my favorite quotes of Charles Spurgeon. He said to a group of young preachers, he said, "Young men, if God has called you to preach, don't stoop to be a king." That's a great view of preaching. Finally, dear church, would you look at John 3:16? Our vision is to realize a church that is committed to world missions. John 3:16. The Bible is very clear that God loves people. And boy, did He prove it when He put His Son on the cross. He put Jesus on the cross to die for the sins of the world. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, so that everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life." The Bible says in 1 John 4:10-11, "This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. In essence, our vision as a church is to go global with the message that God loves people. Our mission field is, of course, Cleburne, Johnson County, Texas, the United States, and the globe. I continue to be amazed at God that He uses Field Street Baptist Church to go to all kinds of places in the world. We've sent teams to Poland. We've sent teams to Cuba. We sent teams to various camps around our country, and largely through Richard and Stephanie Blake, God is advancing His name and His glory and His gospel in all kinds of places in the world through this church, Field Street Baptist Church. What God is doing through His fellowship here is nothing short of truly glorifying to Him. And I'm missing some places that aren't coming to my memory at the moment. But I'm telling you, it is nothing short of a blessing of God that he's using this fellowship to send people out beyond Cleburne, beyond Johnson County, beyond our state and even our own country, to places in the world where the gospel is being proclaimed. Richard's heading to the Philippines very soon. I'm heading to the Philippines in November to train pastors so that they too can be effective in opening the Word of God and preaching truth, and preaching Christ. So what can we do to make sure this vision, this aspect of the vision God has given us, this world missions emphasis, we can pray, we can give, we can send, and we can go. We have the resources to partner with God's servants in many places all over the world. We just must expand our vision. Why? Because God loves the world. And we go because our Father's love compels us. I end with this. When Hudson Taylor was director of the China Inland Mission, he often interviewed candidates for the mission field. On one occasion, he met with a group of applicants to determine, if he could, their motivations for service. He would ask, "And why do you wish to go as a foreign missionary?" He asked one, "Well, I want to go because Christ has commanded us to go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature," was the reply. Another one said, "I want to go because millions are perishing without Christ." And others gave different answers. Then Hudson Taylor said this, quote, "All of these motives, however good, will fail you in times of testing, trials, tribulations, and possible death. There is but one motive that will sustain you in trial and testing, namely, the love of Christ." End quote. The real key to seeing this vision materialized at its essence is our growing love for Christ. And may God increase our love for Christ, because as our love for Christ increases, I have no doubt that this vision will be realized among our church and in our midst to His glory alone. May God give us a great love for His Son. Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, we praise your great name because you are worthy of praise. There is none like you. You are alone, our God. We praise you this morning that you are holy and righteous and just, that you are unfailing in your love, faithful in all your actions, keeping perfectly every promise you have made. And we praise you and thank you this morning that you have a plan and a purpose for Field Street Baptist Church. I pray that you will help us. Most of all, please allow us, please make it happen, please compel us to have a growing love for Christ. And may that growing love be the ultimate motive for why we want to be engaged in your work and be witnesses for you, and to declare and teach your word and then go into all the world. So in these moments, as this message is coming to